They have got a special guest who's going to walk us through his experience with the Patterson Program for Rheumatoid Arthritis. It's going to be really interesting and inspirational. His name is Colin. He is in Ireland, and he came into my world around, as I said, 2 years ago, but he joined the Patterson Program Support, as it was called, or Rheumatoid Support. And ever since, he's been the best possible member, because all he does is post his updates and say how he has been improving. And recently just said, look, he's made it as far as he had ever dreamt to go with his health turnaround, coming off medications, improving his lifestyle, getting rid of pain. So Colin is going to tell us all today. Welcome, Colin.
Hello. Thank you for having me. It's my graduation day today.
Yeah, and you mentioned to me that you have watched a lot of these podcast episodes in the past. So have you found that these have been a part of your journey along the way?
Absolutely. It's the main reason I wanted to do this today, you know, because when I started the program, in my lowest moments, I watched these podcasts, and these were the inspiration for me that kept me going. One in particular, a Spanish guy called Ruben, and this is Ruben here, and I wanted to do a shout out for Ruben because this guy inspired me. I watched his video on repeat all the time when I was down because it was just such a great podcast. And yeah, because look, you know, when you take something on like this, it's such an unknown. And the only thing you're thinking is, I believed it worked. I could tell it worked, but is it going to work for me? And that's the great unknown, I think. So it was that doubt that was eating away in my head throughout, I think, that is it going to work for me? So yeah, when you're eating that buckwheat, you know, three times a day, I think it's the pressing question, really. It has worked.
Well, and it also plays on your mind a little more when your diagnosis is not rheumatoid, because you were diagnosed with psoriatic arthritis. And a common question that we get from people who are, you know, thinking about starting this is, will it work for psoriatic arthritis, or will it work for ankylosing spondylitis, or some variation of the body that's been afflicted by joint inflammation? And so I think it's good to also acknowledge that it was psoriatic arthritis, which was your diagnosis. And for me, just to remind our audience that as far as I'm concerned, as far as the approach is concerned, there are no differences in terms of how we go about this treatment and this condition and our aim to improve. So you were diagnosed with psoriatic arthritis. Why don't you, before you give us the long version, tell us what drugs you're on, what you've been able to come off, and how you feel today compared to when you started?
So, yeah, I was on methotrexate, a drug called Arcoxia, lansoprazole, and then sulfasalazine. That was the cocktail I was taking every morning I took those for about 7 or 8 months. Once I started the program, I quite quickly started trying to wean off as much as I could. I didn't dabble with I kept taking the methotrexate. But yeah, I got results. It took some time, but I was off the methotrexate the following year, and now I am 100% better, pain-free, medication-free. And most importantly for me, back running, because that was the one thing that the arthritis had stopped me from doing. I was desperate to get back to sport and back running, and I'm doing that. So I'm 100% better, yeah.
Yeah, it's just fantastic to see. I know that Dr. McDougall, whenever he gets sent, you know, success stories via email, he always says they never get old. And each time I hear of someone saying that they've improved, in your case, dramatically, and in some cases, just it might be just getting rid of a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, whatever the small improvement might be, it never gets old. And I'm sitting here just, you know, listening to this, not as someone who is on the other side of the sort of transaction of a Patterson program, but as someone, as a person to person, just feeling so happy that you are feeling better, because these diseases, whatever we want to label them from the medical side of things, they're just atrocious. So walk me through how bad you were when this went down, and walk us through the steps that you went through.
Yeah. So initially for me, like I say, my symptoms were, I would say, you know, they weren't good, but they were still fairly mild compared to some of this. I mean, compared to yourself, for example, when I watched your TED talk, and your symptoms were horrendous, but my symptoms got worse was the thing. And that's when I came to the program, because my symptoms got drastically worse quickly. And that's what really scared me. But initially it was May, 2017. It was the end of the month. It was our wedding anniversary, my wife Celine and I's wedding anniversary, my birthday. And I remember it vividly. We had three nights out in a row. And this was kind of a sign of my lifestyle at the time. We had three quite, let's say, over the top meals out, like wine tasting, you know, really, really sort of indulgent meals. Three nights in a row, one for our wedding anniversary, one seeing my parents, we're having like a tapas tasting night, and the third night was my cousin's wedding. So I had three nights in a row on all of the richest foods, wines, and that was the way I was living at the time anyway. My weight was up and down, and I remember waking up days after that three-night feast, as it were, and my inner toe, my ring toe, I think it's called, was purple, was just in agony, burning. And that was the first sign. And I thought, what has happened? I was thinking, was I drunk? Did I kick my toe off something? I had no idea what it was. Just no idea. And it went on, and then the symptoms, and I started getting pains in my little finger, and I played piano. I was thinking, is it that? Am I playing the piano too hard? So just little signs were creeping in. And then I started getting tests done at the doctors. We thought it was maybe gout. You know, and anyway, long story short, it took me 5 months to get diagnosed. And then I was diagnosed in November 2017. Rheumatologist said, you've got psoriatic arthritis, you will be seeing a rheumatologist for the rest of your life, and you'll be on medication for the rest of your life. And I took it fine, to be honest, because after 5 months of pain, I just wanted to get better. So I absolutely no problem. That's my nature. I was like, I'm quite stubborn. I'll just get the head down. I'll do whatever it takes to get better. So that was what happened. And then I started then the medication. She gave me Christmas off. And then I started the medication, as it were, in January. She said, have Christmas, go eat, drink what you want, but you'll be going on methotrexate in January and you'll probably have to stop alcohol. Which, again, I kind of tried to find the positives. I said, right, now is my opportunity to get fit. I'm going to be giving up all these things now. I thought, I'm going to get fit and I'm going to start triathlon, and I'm going to do a triathlon this year. So I started taking the medication. Started making some dietary adjustments, because you know what it's like. You start reading up, don't you, about other things that can help. But there's so much information out there about, you know, what to eat, what not to eat. But until I found the program, then I really found out what not to eat, you know. But yeah, I remember chuckling to myself initially. It was like, the three things that you should not eat if you've got arthritis are red wine, bread, and steak, I think it was at that. And I was just like, oh, these are my favorite things in the world. And beer. I was like, oh my God. So anyway, I spent 4 or 5 months taking the medication. Side effects, hard to tell, but I think, you know, I felt like I was getting like kind of sort of brain fog. And I think when I went on the sulfasalazine, especially, I started to really notice then just, I think even psychologically, I was 39, I was getting up in the morning and I was taking 4 or 5 pills in the morning. You know, I think just that was getting into my head a bit. I started making some dietary changes, like I say. But then sort of like 5, 6 months in, I had like a bit of a knock in my career. I was going for a job and it didn't work out or something like that. I was on my holidays in Ireland with my parents and I said, screw this, I'm going to eat and drink what I want for a week on holiday. And I ate like fried foods, had some alcohol again, stuff like this. And I mean, within days, I went from someone that was having some pain in my foot and unable to run to not able to get out of bed, like agony. It hit my chest bone. My hands were like in excruciating pain. And that scared the hell out of me. And then it was just, what do I do? And that was my lowest ebb. Like I think it all hit me at that point. Maybe I was in denial about the whole thing up to that point, but I was in a really dark place then.
It's really cruel how this happens. I mean, I remember a similar experience where you're in a situation where you're meant to be happy and you're meant to be celebrating and it's a good time. And then your body at that precise moment says, this is when I'm going to, you know, really fall apart. And for me, it was, I proposed to Melissa. We were in a place called Blue Mountains, which is about an hour out of Sydney. And it's a gorgeous place with spectacular views and valleys and flying white cockatoos. And we got up early in the morning and I proposed in the morning agonizingly on my left knee. And that night, we just to celebrate, just went to a local restaurant and I had pizza for the first time in a long time, because we'd already been sort of exploring improved dietary habits. And then the next day, you know, the day after we've gotten engaged and I'm just hurting, you know, I was hurting from that pizza. And I don't think I've ever eaten it since. So that's going back a long time. So I understand the body just, the body doesn't like parties, does it?
No. And I just shut down at that point. And, you know, I was actually, while all this was going on, I was on the waiting list to go on Humira, because I read about Humira and I was so excited. I was like, this is the cure. This is what, if I can get this, I can go back to my old ways of life and I'll be healed. So it was sort of I hit this juncture in my life where I was desperate to get the cure. Well, I'm assuming that was the biologic, you know, and I know the biologic does work for a lot of people. But at the same time, I watched your TED talk. And when I watched the TED talk, it was just, my mind was blown, because I had actually said to Celine up to this point, my wife, I'd said, I have not been ill at all in my life. And it is just like someone has switched the tap on. And I was like, there must be a way to switch this off. And I haven't got a medical bone in my body. So I wasn't the person that was going to find that out. But then I watched your TED talk and I just knew that was, this guy has been through this. This is real and this is how to fix it. So I watched your TED talk. I think I signed up to the Palisson program. And then the next day I had the phone call saying, come to the clinic and we've got your Humira ready. And wow. I said, well, I'm not sure I want to take it now. And they said, well, just come in anyway and talk to the rheumatologist. So I literally was sitting in the clinic with like six other patients opposite me. And I pretty much now in my head, I know there's a way out of this. And I mean, there was no dilemma. I just said to the rheumatologist, I'm going another way with this, a dietary way. And, you know, I mean, I have to be honest, anyone medical I've spoken to throughout this process, that it's always met with pretty much apathy at best, you know. They're like, okay, diet. Yeah, okay. So that was it. I walked out of there and it was just like the most empowering feeling to walk away from what I knew would be a really good solution for me, the biologic, to go and embark on this, jumping off a cliff really into the abyss, which is really what it was, really taking on the program. I knew what you had done was real, but again, it was, will this work for me? And I think that for me was just the great unknown, and you know, but yeah, I did it.
And Anthony Robbins, you know, I used to attend Anthony Robbins seminars quite a lot, and I did his university, which involves going to Fiji and doing all sorts of mastery courses, as he says. He has a great phrase, which is burn the boats, which is a reference to a short story that he always tells, which is that if, you know, a small group of tribes people are on a canoe or a set of canoes, and then they want to take over an island and occupy the island as the, you know, and force themselves upon the current occupants and become new residents. Then they jump off the boats, swim towards the island, and someone burns the boats. And so there's no way out. There's no way back. And I just thought of that when you were talking about walking away from the Humira. You burnt the boat. There's no way back. You basically just went for it. And that mentality tends to sow deep roots of determination when you know it's this way.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, there were boats burned. And thankfully, though, I have to say my wife was there with the petrol can, because she was totally my, you know, rock through this. That cliche is so true. You know, I've recommended this program to other people, and people probably not as fortunate to have a support system like I had. But the weekend I started the program, which was this day 2 years ago, which is why I wanted to do the podcast today, Celine was there with the juices and I was trying to work, and she was just bringing it in on the, we had a schedule going, and so it was amazing. And she actually said, I'm going to do this with you. I'm going to do it with you. And to be fair, she lasted a week because she was eating the buckwheat with me. And then even she sort of like went, right, you're off on your own now. But her support was incredible. And you know, your partner has to sacrifice too, because eating out for us was such a big part of our life, you know. And she sacrificed all of that, you know, because she was desperate for me to get better, you know. And it was a long road, you know, those months on the buckwheat. And, you know, one of the hardest ones for me was we were going on holiday quite soon after I started the program. I started in August, and then we went on holiday in October to Mallorca. And I brought the little rice machine with me, and eating out, you know, on holiday, you know, was again such a big part of eating out, and that was hard, and my weight was dropping off at a rate of knots at that point too, you know. So I went from, you know, walking around healthy. When I was unhealthy, I'd have been 13 stone, healthy 12. I dropped down to 10-3 really quite quickly. And, you know, then you get family that are worried about you. Yeah. I took a little bit of time off work, and I wasn't even sure if work weren't sure if they, I wasn't sure they believed me work when I was saying I needed some time off. And then I came back to work after 3 months and they saw me, and you could just see people's faces going, what has happened to him? But, you know, and again, those things start to weigh in your mind. You know, I started to get insecure about my weight. It's incredible. The guy that was always trying to get his weight down was suddenly, I was wearing heavy jumpers to hide the fact I dropped so much weight. It was a crazy, crazy first 3 or 4 months, you know, going through that. But again, I think my determination, inspiration from you, the support group, from Ruben, my Spanish friend, I think just that kept me going, and I just got my head down and I just started embracing it. And I was just, give me the buckwheat. And I was like buying these giant sacks of buckwheat and just getting stuck into it, like just like a savage. And but I stuck with it. And, you know, slowly but surely, and I made mistakes. As you know, you're looking at that food plan about the advanced foods, and was constantly wanting to get to advanced, you know, and there'd be a little spike in pain and you'd have to, you know, retreat and go back to basics, you know. But yeah, it was a war zone in the early days.
Yeah, there's no end to the challenges that get thrown at you when you're trying to heal. One of them you emphasize is the weight loss, and I personally faced that with family members and friends as well. Became very self-conscious, as you did. And in my case, it was really extreme because I did 8 months of a raw food diet. And for folks watching or listening, there's a certain weight loss with a sort of low fat elimination baseline kind of Patterson program diet. And then there's a whole new level below that, which is a raw vegan diet. And I actually, you know, don't recommend people go raw vegan for that purpose, even though it's extraordinarily cleansing and health healing, I want to say. I don't know about healthy. I don't know if it's too extreme. And that's why I don't recommend it. I want to sleep at night feeling comfortable that people are doing something that I have done personally and felt safe doing. Yeah, the weight loss seems to worry family members more than if a family member were taking 15 different medications. It's a strange thing. My family members would prefer that you're doing a cocktail of drugs than looking like you're underweight. Did you also find that strange phenomenon exists?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, like when you tell people, I found this guy on the internet, you know, that has the cure, the first thing, they're like, you're crazy. You know, I had this massive falling out with my brother who has been really supportive as well. But initially he was just like, Cole, this guy's giving you false hope. What are you doing? You're paying. Like, it was just, and it really, really infuriated me, you know, because I'm not stupid. I've got good instincts, and I knew you weren't a fraud, Clint. I knew this was legit, you know. But yeah, when you say that to people, I found this other way on the internet, or, you know, it's met with just, you know, absolute cynicism, and for good reason, because there are plenty of con men out there. But yeah, the weight loss. Yeah, my parents were worried about me. Of course they were. And I wasn't worried about me. That's the thing, isn't it? You know, people that love you, they're worried for you, but I wasn't. You know, I just wanted to get better and get back. But I think the other thing that contributed to my weight loss was, you know, I was at base plan stage, you know, eating these really basic foods, but I was also probably over-exercising because my other way of getting through it was, because you recommended a bit of exercise, I took that to the extreme, you know, and I was like, I'm going to do triathlon, I'm going to get super fit. And so I was probably overtraining as well. So I was always at a, you know, calorie sort of deficiency probably.
And what we find, and you would have found is that if we look at extremes, if we don't eat then everything goes away for almost everyone. Like you have zero pain, right? And so subconsciously, that's attractive. It is. And then, but the opposite being true in that extreme eating, particularly high fat foods, animal foods, we're going to feel very, very high levels of inflammation, but maintaining weight's trivial. And, you know, if you look around with people without any kind of reasons to restrict their eating, most people are overweight. Okay. So, with that sort of platform in our mind and us hating and loathing the pain, it's easy to sort of want to take the road of low pain and less calorie intake because it feels better on our joints. And that's what only someone with inflammatory arthritis can understand through that experience. And also when you look around and everyone's overweight, it just seems absolutely impossible to be underweight unless you've got cancer or something really terrible, right? Because food is so abundant and easy to access and so overly laden with unhealthiness that most people are fat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean...
So, yeah, let's talk about your exercise. You know that I recommend it. I think that over-exercising is a far better error than under. So tell me about your exercising and how that helped drive down inflammation and make you feel.
Well, I mean, even on a sort of an emotional level, you know, the endorphin hit you get from exercise is just, you know, incredible. So even on that level, it helped me get through. It gave me a new focus, you know, to replace that kind of, you know, party animal eating too much, eating out too much person that I was. You know, it gave me a different focus, you know, it was replacing one thing with another. But I obviously, you know, I played a lot of football when I was younger. I was probably quite a talented runner, but because my diet was so up and down, I was never really probably achieved what I could have achieved, you know, in terms of taking part in, you know, marathons and stuff. So, but I wanted to get so desperately get back to running that this pain that began in that little toe wouldn't shift. That was the one area I could not shift the pain in. So I took up swimming alongside doing the Bikram yoga. I took up swimming, you know, and I grew up swimming breaststroke in the pool, but I started to learn front crawl and I just started swimming just like four times a week and stuff like that. And obviously swimming's amazing if you've got any joint pains, you know. And, you know, swimming led to then getting a swimming coach and joining a triathlon club. And yeah, I mean, like last year I took part in an event up here, 150 swimmers, came third overall. Someone that never swam, you know, and doing more races. And I've joined a triathlon club here in Galway. And I love swimming and I'm quite talented at it. You know, I'm not club swimmer talented, but as a triathlete, I'm a talented triathlete swimmer, you know. So that, and then yoga, obviously. I came to the yoga a little bit later than I had planned, but I found a hot yoga clinic in Belfast, joined that. And that was just amazing because, again, I had this back pain and shoulder pain. And I was only doing the hour-long classes. And I found great relief from that. And again, even just psychologically, just those small moments of meditation in those classes was just a great way to step out from work, step away from the program and just take some time to just think and, you know, just kind of clear the head, you know. So the yoga was amazing. And I went to that yoga class for easily a year, year and a half and loved it. And then I actually started to realize all this time doing endurance sport, whether it's running or cycling, Bikram yoga is the hardest 90 minutes of that class is seriously kick-ass. If you can come through that and do the exercises properly, like I would see guys coming into this class who had obviously been brought in by friends, fit, really fit, ripped rugby player guys. They were walking out of that class within half an hour to an hour because it is hardcore. And, you know, you are getting to the point of passing out, I found, you know, with just the heat, the heart rate, and I loved it. I really loved it. So I'm going to go back to that, you know. But yes, when I was on the program, it's intense.
Oh, yeah. Look, there's no part of this that isn't intense, is it? The dietary side's extremely challenging. And then you've got the highest recommendation that I provide, which is the Bikram yoga, which, as you described, is like above all else is so challenging. But I say, I just back this up and say what we're looking for is results, and we're up against the worst possible sort of inflammatory challenge we could ever unfortunately hope to have in our lives. And if we have a massive energy enemy, we need a massive offense. And this is what it is. It's about taking the best of the best and putting it together to give ourselves the best possible chance. And you've done that. And your results are nothing short of extraordinary. And so your rheumatologist, if you're still seeing the same one, has very likely never in his career seen someone achieve what you've achieved. And that's because you've put all of the pieces of the puzzle together, these very, very challenging parts, and you've just gone and done it. So I'm interested to get your feedback that you heard from him or her.
Her. She was lovely and really supportive. I've been discharged, so I'm not seeing her anymore because I've moved home from Belfast to the Republic of Ireland quite recently, and she knew that was coming up. She just said, Colin, I'm going to discharge you because you're better and you're not taking any medication. So, you know, like I say, I came off methotrexate last July. You know, I could have done this podcast with you last year, Clint, to be honest. I mean, the reason it's taken me so long to get around to doing it was purely because I wanted to have some triathlon medals around my neck, but COVID unfortunately got in the way of that. So all the events I was going to do have been put on hold. Whenever I first told Dr. Bull that I was doing this program, I mean, she was supportive. Again, she was, you know, that they just, she's not a nutritionist, you know. She said to me, yeah, look, I mean, I know some people have, you know, have benefits, you know, from making dietary changes. But when I told her what my changes were, she was like, wow, well, how are you going to lead a life when you can't eat out anymore and all those things? And, you know, and I guess, yeah, there are medication enables you to continue exactly where you left off. You have to take a different direction with this, you know. But I'm very happy with the direction that my life's taken, and I am back eating out, and I eat an amazing diet of food now, you know. I wouldn't change it for the world. To be in the situation that I'm in now, off medication, pain-free, back running, and, you know, eating an expansive plant-based diet, I'm happy.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Let's explore your diet a little bit more. Tell us, you know, if you have some omissions, or if it's easier, just tell us what you can eat in terms of, you know, the diversity.
I don't think there are any omissions in terms of plant-based food.
Yep.
I even have some little cheats now and again. I have a little beer every now and again. I don't have a lot of alcohol, but I have some alcohol. I just take every recipe on the sun from the internet. Your good wife, Melissa, back in the day was where I started. Then Ida, the kitchen fairy, Ida, who's done the program. And now the Happy Pair, the guys over here in Ireland who do have their own YouTube channel, take a lot of their foods. If they cook with oil, I omit oil. I stay generally strictly to plant-based food, and I cut all out all oils, and it works. You know,
That's it. That's the magic formula, and that's where we're heading. So I think it's really important, because we spend a lot of time talking about, you know, the challenges and being very transparent. You know, we're just being straight up. This is hard work. This requires determination. This is a big commitment. Nothing's easy. You'll be faced with challenges. But then on the flip side, you know, we're now talking about how you have a very diverse plant-based diet without exceptions. You can have the occasional beer. And the only thing that you avoid that's commonly in plant-based diets is oil. And we, oil isn't a natural food anyway. It's a processed food. It's something that typically is highly inflammatory. We have this concept of, omega-3s versus omega-6s and so forth. But once you heat oil, the free radical damage that's done to the body is significant. It increases oxidative stress. It coagulates the red blood cells. It just makes you feel sluggish. And so it's not a natural food. It causes us to have more inflammation. And it's just something that we have to say, okay, look, I'm a little bit high maintenance. When I go to the restaurant, I'm going to ask for no oil on my naan bread, no ghee or whatever. And I'm going to ask for foods that, you know, when I have cooked with friends, don't cook with oil. And as long as that's done, then you're not that difficult to please when you eat out. It's not hard to do at home, that's for sure.
Yeah, it's not that drastic a lifestyle change, actually, whenever you think of all the benefits that I have now of living this way compared to the alternative. Yeah, so I have to phone a restaurant in advance, you know, or if I'm in a new city, which I am now, I have to, I'm trying to find restaurants that can cater for me. But once I find five or six, and I will, that gives us options to go and eat out, you know, which is great. No, the food has been revelatory, really, because again, I mean, I remember speaking to vegans prior to me ever getting involved in, you know, eating this type of food. And the first thing you think is, what do you eat? What do you possibly eat? And then when you actually delve into it and you explore all the possibilities, the food is amazing. Like, it really is amazing and colorful and rich and tasty, you know. Takes a bit more time to prepare it, obviously, but it's great.
Yeah, it's time well spent, right?
Yeah.
It's better than time recovering from agonizing, you know, reactions to the bad foods. Can you tell me a couple of things I want to touch upon before we close out? I want to talk about your achievements with your exercise and your competition triathlons just a little bit more, because you know, that's fascinating to me, how your body's responding and whether or not you feel competitive on these plant-based diet, and how you might compare what you would have been like if you'd have been eating, you know, conventional foods. And then I also want to talk about what your experience and approach was with getting off the sortilizine and the methotrexate. So there's people who are on those drugs, and I want them to learn how you went about it. So in any order, if you could let us know on those two topics.
So in terms of the exercise where I am now, I'm still quite lean, obviously, because I'm not eating, you know, hundreds of grams of protein. Trying to take in the amount of protein required to build muscle, you know, it's an astronomical amount of food. And I have tried it, but I'm just not sure I need it, to be honest. I mean, I think I was recommended that I'd need to be taking about 120 grams a day to be building the muscle, like, you know, significant muscle gains, you know. And that is like an awful lot of chickpeas, kidney beans. It's also not true.
Yeah, it's also not true. Yeah. So I've gained weight on orange juice and white rice. I put on 3 kilos in a month one time just eating that. Yeah. So like, it's not true. Yeah.
What I find is when I'm in a really strict routine of training anyway, I'm getting good physique from swimming, you know, anyway, you know, lean and, you know, and fast through the water, you know. So in that respect, fine. Slightly more challenging for me has been just recovering from not having been on my feet for 4 years. You know, I was not running for 4 years or so because, you know, there were so many other injuries prior to my arthritis diagnosis that were possibly arthritis related, but just my legs just haven't had that conditioning, you know. So for me, and again, because I'm an idiot, when I go out and train, I'm still overtraining a bit on the running. I'm going out, and as soon as I get the music in, I'm like flying out of the blocks, you know, and doing 5-6 miles at sub-7 minute pace. And then it's taken me a week to recover, you know, but I'm just so happy and excited to be back running that it's hard to kind of cage that enthusiasm, to be honest, because it's just, when I'm out running now, it's just like the miracle is complete for me. So in that sense, if I calm down a little bit and I start going a little bit slower, a little bit longer, I would probably, get the conditioning back, you know, because my Achilles is a bit tight, you know, after going out so hard and so fast and stuff like that. So, yeah, trying to, I guess, get the tendons and stuff back fit and strong, I guess, is a challenge for me, but easily fixable. And then in terms of cycling, I think for me, you know, cycling, stamina gets you so far. It's a power sport. And I feel like, you know, to get the calves strong, really, and put power through the pedals, I feel like, you know, that may need just more time. It's the one discipline of the three that I've spent the least time on. You know, I've been swimming a hell of a lot, back running now. So the bike's kind of the final kind of piece of the jigsaw for me. It's a challenge. It's a challenge when you're eating a plant-based diet, but it's, you know, like I say, I'm competing against people that eat regular food, and I'm getting on the podium. So that's great, you know? And then in terms of the methotrexate and the sulfasalazine, it was how I came off them. Is that what you were asking?
Yes. What strategies did you use, and were you working closely with your rheumatologist, and whether or not she was supportive, and just the whole, you know, just anything that might be helpful for anyone wanting to do that?
Yeah. I mean, it was the one drug. I think I was taking I was taking painkillers when I started the program. And I remember watching one of your videos that said that they are really bad for your gut health. So that was the one drug I just dropped overnight. As soon as I watched that, I thought, I need to get this out of my body because there's no point in me doing this program, which may have been a bit reckless. And I did see a little spike in pain because I dropped it so quickly. I didn't wean off it. But it was a spike I was willing to take because I just thought, this is just going to inhibit my progress. What's the point in making all these dietary sacrifices if I'm still taking something else that's going to, you know, affect my gut health? So that one I dropped quickly. But in terms of the methotrexate, I stayed very strictly to your kind of, you know, your schedule on that and how to go about that and how to wean off that. And I did that really strictly. I can't remember exactly the amounts I was taking, but, you know, I weaned off month by month very gradually. And I did speak to my rheumatologist about it. And she said, yeah, if you're feeling better, drop another, you know, 2.5 mils or something like that. And I think it was like a 4 month process. And I slowly came off that. Sulfasalazine, I don't think there was any weaning off that. And that was the one I was glad to get rid of. Because for me, I just felt that one combined with the other medication, I felt like it was giving me side effects that weren't pleasant for me. The methotrexate was the weaning process. And, you know, and then there's also that other unknown at the other side of all this. You know, the unknown at the start is this going to work for me? Then it's working. Then it's that weaning process. And then you think, right, I'm getting into this final phase now. When I stop the methotrexate, is it going to come back? And that's always your fear, isn't it? This thing. And it didn't, you know. And I think by the time I got to that point, you know, it had been a year, and, you know, I probably could have weaned off it sooner. You know, I was probably seeing really good results within 4 or 5 months of the program, to be honest. I was up to advanced foods within 6 months easily. So I really took my time with that final 6 months really before I came off it. But yeah, once I did, it was just like, it felt natural. I was ready. I knew it. You know, it's a very strange experience, this whole thing, in the sense that you go from this absolute extreme diet, weight loss, to then the foods do start to improve. Then you get to advanced, and then the final stages, I wouldn't like to say take them for granted, but suddenly I was better. Suddenly I was 100% better, and I didn't even notice it because I'd put in so much work and effort to those first 6 months. You know, so yeah, that was it. And I need to thank you, you know, because it was your TED talk. It was all of your, you know, all the work you put into the program and your videos and your literature and then your help from Melissa and your podcast and Dr. McDougall as well. You know, I watched a lot of his videos as well. You know, it was just the work you guys have put into this. You know, it was if you hadn't been out there, I would never have been here. I'd have been, you know, back taking the meds and doing something else, you know. And so, yeah, thank you.
Well, thank you, Colin, because, I think you may have heard me say this before, but Melissa and I spoke about this, and Melissa said that if we only help one person by documenting everything and pulling it all together and putting it up on the internet, then it will be worth my experience and worth putting the time into. Make it all and put, you know, so much time has been put into cross-referencing the scientific studies and making sure that some of our personal experiences, and I say ours because Melissa was there for me the entire time, were compatible with the feedback that we get from other people who use the program, because some of it, you can't put science behind it. Science has never been done in some small aspects of the program. Yeah, so thank you, because you know, yourself is the picture we had in our mind for when we were struggling too. I got excited and I thought, if I can get through this and I'm onto something here and that this can help other people, then that was motivating for me. So, you know, we all have people to thank, and as you mentioned, Dr. McDougall, and it's endless other people who I drew from as well. So we're all just sharing information, and now you're going to inspire people the same way that Ruben touched upon you, and, you know, we're all just doing something for each other.
That's why I wanted to do this podcast really, because I just know that in my darkest, lowest moments, you know, watching these helped me so much that I thought the same thing you've just said. If one person watches this and is inspired by it, and it's the motivation that says, yeah, I'm going to keep eating this buckwheat, I'm going to keep going, you know, I just think it's worth doing, because, you know, this program works, you know, it works, and it can work for you. You just have to put the effort in, because, you know, and it's a huge effort. It's a massive push, but you can get there, you know, and it's so worth it. It is so worth it, because when you're in your lowest kind of points with this whole horrible condition, like, you don't see a way out of it, you know? And there is a way out, you know, there is another way. And I think that's really important. And I think it's just worth reminding people that there are so many of us who have come through and are happier and healthier for it.
Yeah. Thanks, Colin. So a little call to action to anyone who's watching this, who knows someone who's done this program and has done fabulously well, and or perhaps it's yourself and you have a great story to share, something inspirational, then please reach out to me, because, you know, I love doing these interviews, and constant feedback I get is, you know, I just listen to the podcast is what I hear from everyone, and I love the stories and they keep me going. So exactly like you've described, Colin, and you know, I'm very grateful to have had this chat with you today and to meet you personally after, as I said at the beginning of this conversation, you joined the support platform. I don't think you asked for help more than about twice, and the rest of the time you would just pop in every couple of months and you'd say, this is where I'm up to, I'm making progress, and we'd all cheer you on, and then you'd disappear for another 2 months, you know.
And back to the buckwheat. Yeah, but you know, that's it was just such an amazing resource to be able to connect with other people going through the same thing as you, to share that kind of information, to ask questions, you know, are these foods safe? What do people think of this? To share food recipes, you know, it's invaluable, you know, and the food is such a big thing, you know, like, to be able to share food recipes, you know, in those early stages, just when you're able to advance that little bit further, to find something with that bit more flavor in it, you know, it just pushes you on, you know? So yeah, it's a great resource, and I'd highly recommend it to anyone watching if they're thinking about, you know, signing up. Absolutely, go for it. Embrace it. Embrace the buckwheat. That's my motto. Eat the buckwheat. Eat the buckwheat. You will get there.
On you, mate. Well, I guess, you know, you don't have a website or anything like that. You've got nothing to promote and nothing to sort of share in that department. And so I'm not going to ask you for that, but do you have a social media platform where people could watch and see if you've, you know, got on the podium again with an upcoming triathlon or something similar?
Yeah, you can find me on Twitter at coldogodonnell, coldogodonnell. That's my Twitter handle. Look, this whole thing has changed my life in such an incredible way. I may well get down right. I'm a screenwriter by trade. I may sit down and, you know, if the triathlon stuff takes off, I might write a book. I don't know. My wife and I are talking about maybe opening a hotel in Spain or Mallorca that caters to Palisson program, people that sign up to the program, stuff like that. Because that was the big thing for me. When you're abroad, there's nowhere to eat, you know. So we've been talking about various ideas, but I'll be back in touch if any of those things, you know, come to fruition. Certainly find me on Twitter. If anyone has any questions, I'd be more than happy to help.
Fantastic. Well, good on you, Colin. Much appreciated. I'll let you go and enjoy the rest of your day. And I just want to thank you again.
Thank you, and good luck to everybody. Thank you.